which the demon had called a gem. If they really were after Sylvie, then avoiding them indefinitely wasn't going to be possible. Third, there was going to be a war in Dicathan. This continent would be in danger, and we definitely weren't prepared. Something about what Alea said, how the demon had told her that there would be a war, made me feel sure that the black-horned demons weren't from this continent. Was the new continent, the one we had just discovered, filled with these demons? I shuddered at that thought. Yet if there truly was a race of superpowered beings aligned against us, why would they be sneaking around our dungeons and infecting the mana beasts instead of marching across Dicathan and annihilating us? They were obviously uncertain whether they could take on the whole continent, so they were going about it discreetly, at least for now. How long had the demons prepared for this war? When would they bring their attacks to the surface? Was war inevitable? Was waiting the only thing I could do? All that we could do? A sharp pain in my hands made me realize how hard I was clenching my fists. I relaxed them, then watched the drops of blood running down my forearm. I was slowly learning, and Alea's death had reinforced the realization just how much I valued my relationships with my family, with Tess, and with my friends. In my past life, I hadn't had anyone I would have given my life for to protect. I had that now, but I didn't have the strength to protect them. Not against what was about to come. Despite all my potential, I had grown complacent. That needed to change. I recalled the message Sylvia had given me after she teleported me into Elshire Forest. The words still rang clearly in my head. I would hear from her again once my core passed the white stage. That was the most certain method I currently knew of to get some reliable answers. However, I was still unable to break past the threshold of dark yellow stage. After yellow was silver, and then white, I still had a ways to go. A ferocious roar sounded, echoing off the cavern walls.
Papa!
My head jerked up. The roar was soon followed by a loud crash coming from where I had fallen. Picking myself up, I dashed towards Sylvie's voice, stopping in front of a cloud of dust and calling out to her.
I'm here, Sylv. Are you okay?
I covered my face with my arms as the dust cloud instantly blew away, revealing my precious bond in her full glory. Sylvie's natural dragon form had become even more fearsome than when I last saw it at the Dire Tombs. If she had looked crudely fierce back then, the feeling I got now was more akin to awe. Her scales were no longer glossy. They were now a dignified matte black. Her two horns had grown even longer, extending past her snout, and another pair of horns protruded underneath them. She appeared as majestic as she did deadly. The spikes that used to run down her back were gone, making her seem more refined. Her gem-like, iridescent yellow eyes pierced through me. Could it truly be that this magnificent creature still referred to me as Papa?
Papa, you're okay.
She lifted me up from the ground with the force of her leg, dispelling the bewildering awe that had held me in place.
You got bigger again, Sylv.
I beamed a childish smile and hugged the snout of my dragon, and Sylvie let out a deep purr as she rubbed herself against me. For just a moment, I was able to forget everything I'd just been through. Lifting me off the ground with her snout, she placed me on her broad, muscular back.
Hold on, Papa. Let's get out of here.
She gave a powerful snap of her wings, a raging gust formed underneath us, and we were propelled into the air. Though I hardly noticed in the moment, the sudden force didn't affect my body, and I rode comfortably on the back of my dragon. During the flight back up, Sylvie and I caught up on everything that had happened while we were separated. She didn't really understand everything about the demons and the upcoming war, but she did get the sense that whatever was about to happen wasn't good.
Don't worry. Whatever happens, I'll be with you.
Sylvie's innocent response left me chuckling. Like a narration from a children's book, she told me a bit about what she'd been up to, mostly fighting beasts and consuming beast cores. I needed to be there with Sylvie the next time she trained, I thought. I was curious as to what she was capable of. Sylvie didn't really know the distinction between the various levels of mana beasts, so I was left pondering just how powerful she actually was. surface. As I had expected, there was no one here. I breathed a sigh of relief, knowing that everyone else had escaped safely. I had to hurry. It was a several-hour trek to the nearest teleportation gate. First, however, I released a pulse of wind around me to make sure there wasn't anyone hiding nearby. Satisfied I wasn't being watched, I retrieved the seal from my dimension ring and was about to put it on. An image of a Leia flashed into my mind, and I paused, studying the seal carefully. Then I took out the black fragment of the demon's horn, the horn of the demon that had killed her, and considered it as well. My mind made up, I took a deep breath and put the seal back into my dimension ring. No more hiding. A churning sensation stirred within my stomach. I had bigger things to worry about now. Fitting in, hiding the truth of my power, that wasn't important anymore. This demon horn shard would be my constant reminder of that.
What's that, Papa?
Sylvie's head popped up, and she reached for the black shard with a paw. It's my goal, Sylvie, I said, determination stealing my body and calming my mind. Patting my bond's furry little head, I began my trip back. The guard in charge of the teleportation gate looked startled to see me. He must have had orders to be on the lookout for me, because as soon as he verified my identity, he hurriedly began making multiple calls using the artifact he had on hand. Then, he quickly ushered me through the gate. I arrived back at Xyrus feeling a little queasy, but was glad to see that there was a driver waiting for me at the teleportation gate. He tipped his hat with a sympathetic smile and opened the door for me. My mind wandered. I kept thinking of the future. For the first time in either of my lives, I felt the pressure of keeping my loved ones safe. I'd never felt that, even when I was a kid. The weight of a country I'd had no affection for in my previous life couldn't compare to the few lives I would give everything for in this one. We reached Helstia Manor, and I bid the driver good day, but I stopped when the Aurora Constellate would begin. My eyes focused on a solitary cloud, slow dancing above me without a care in the world. What an envious position to be in. Son, lost in my thoughts, I hadn't even heard the door open behind me. Hi, Dad. I'm back. I gave him a weak smile. Why didn't you come in? We heard from the teleportation gatekeeper that you'd arrived at Xyrus. My father took a seat next to me when I didn't respond. Your mother will be fine, Odd, he said warmly, gently patting my back. I worried you guys again, didn't I? Feels like that's all I'm really good for nowadays. I gave a humorless laugh, knots churning in my chest. I turned to look at my father and saw him gazing up at the sky like I had been doing just moments before. She really loves the Aurora Constellate. You may not see it, but your mother is strong, Arthur, even stronger than me. If you think all you've given us are worries, then you're wrong. Both you and your sister have given your mother and I so much more than we could have hoped for. I know you're not like the normal children your age. Hell, I've known that since you were born. I don't know what sort of destiny you'll be caught up in, but I don't think it'll be anything you can't handle. The skin around his eyes wrinkled as he gave me a reassuring smile. I stayed silent, unable to form the right words. I don't want you to feel like you're being a burden on us. All this guilt that you're feeling right now, the weight that you're probably feeling, I want you to come to us so we can be there for you. I don't ever want you to feel like you can't come home, that you aren't welcome. As long as you have the use of your two legs, I expect you to come home whenever you can and let us love you. That is our.